Inspired by the life of the savvy and ambitious Colombian businesswoman Griselda Blanco, comes a new Netflix original limited series. Griselda tells the story of a devoted mother who, with her lethal blend of charm and relentless savagery, creates one of the most powerful cartels in history. Witness Sofia Vergara's captivating transformation into the godmother of the underworld. Griselda, now streaming only on Netflix.
I'm Mo Rocca, and I'm excited to announce season 4 of my podcast, Mobituaries. I've got a whole new bunch of stories to share with you about the most fascinating people and things who are no longer with us. From famous figures who died on the very same day, to the things I wish would die, like buffets. All that and much more. Listen to Mobituaries with Mo Rocca wherever you get your podcasts.
BNABCs.
Welcome to the Give Pause a Chance podcast, where we discuss every John Lennon song about Yoko Ono.
Oh no.
Tonight, we will be discussing one of the earliest non-Beatles songs, Oh Yoko, which, interestingly enough, has been covered by another of my favorite bands. But before we get to that, I'd like to introduce my co-host for tonight, Heidi and Aaron.
Oh,
hey,
no.
Everybody. Oh, no.
Did I get it wrong? Am I doing the wrong podcast tonight?
I think you, oh no, Tracy. Oh no.
In the middle of the night. In the middle of the night, I call your name. Oh, Yoko. Oh, Yoko. My love will turn you on.
Oh, so we are doing that song. Okay, good, good, yeah. We're just doing the Bare Naked Ladies version tonight, is that right?
In the middle of a shave. In the middle of a shave, I call your name. In the middle of a dream. In the middle of a dream, I call your name.
I think you've got some instant karma headed your way.
Oh, good one, nice. Aaron. Good one, Aaron.
So, yeah, we're discussing the Bare Naked Ladies version off the Instant Karma album, which was done by Amnesty International campaign to raise money to save Darfur at the time that they were having a major war and problem. This version of the song you can find on the complete recordings. If you buy just the 24 song disc or double disc set, then you will not get this. You have to get the total 61 song discs.
Yeah, I'm not sure it's worth the 61. I don't know.
I don't know, depending on how much it costs. Like
it was for a good cause, right? I don't know.
For a good cause. Did we save Darfur?
I think so, but
it's the whole thing.
Okay.
I think
it made a difference.
My guess is that the money now goes to something else, like it's just Amnesty. So Yoko gave all of John Lennon's songs to Amnesty International, all the rights and earnings from the songs to Amnesty International. And they decided to then, because there was so much of a call and so many bands wanted to do it, that's when they're like, you know what? Let's make an album out of this to release instead of just a few releases. And that's when they did the whole 24 disc set, but then they had even more people. So they're like, all right, we'll release the whole complete recordings of all 61 bands. And this was back in 2007. I think the money still goes to Amnesty International at this point. They still have the rights and reserves for it. So, but yeah.
A lot of good bands on there. He had the Deftones, Duran Duran.
Oh, I used to love the Deftones.
You too?
I thought you meant you too. You also used to like the Deftones?
You too, Duran Duran. Well, you too never met a... You two never met a cause they didn't like. So.
That's true.
That is true. Willie Nelson.
Oh, yeah.
The Cure. Nice. Regina Spektor, Postal Service.
The usual suspects, yeah. Willie Nelson, like, yeah. Like a farm aid.
Come on. Flaming Lips.
Flaming Lips, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's a real. Mick Fleetwood, Jackson Browne.
Hmm.
Like, there's some really great bands on here.
Great bands.
R.E.M., The Cure, Green Day.
All the best bands of 2007. Dijon bands of 2007.
Yes, the fanciest Dijon band.
The fanciest Dijon band.
I mean, before we go into the BNL version, I would like to kind of discuss, one, the original O Yoko song, and then also I'd like to discuss, like, more of what this album really kind of has on it. I mean, this was a pretty big seller. The digital version of this album actually hit number one on iTunes in Portugal, Ireland, Greece, Denmark, and Luxembourg.
Sheesh.
And the physical album actually reached number one in Ireland and Mexico. And it did pretty well in the United States, too. So, and interestingly enough, the Ozzy Osbourne song that was recorded for this album did not get added to even the 61-song disc.
And really?
He recorded a version of How. And they held on to it and then later released it as another way to raise money for another cause later on.
I'm going to have to look that up because I like John Lennon and I like Ozzy Osbourne.
It's interesting. It's a very interesting version.
You've got Avril Lavigne and Big and Rich and Black and Pete. Like, it's such an eclectic
album.
Like, I wanted to go over some of these. Like, some of them are really interesting. It starts off with Nobody Told Me by Abdul Wright, and it's a reggae version of Nobody Told Me, which is really, really intriguing because I've always thought Nobody Told Me had a very reggae type feeling to the beat of it. And to hear it actually done full reggae is really cool. But then the next song after that is Give Peace a Chance. I'm sorry, John, I hate the song Give Peace a Chance. But it's
all we're saying is Give Peace a Chance.
I gave it a chance and I didn't like it. it's too repetitive for me. But I get the purpose for it and I get how big it was and I get what they were saying. I mean, they tell us several times.
Well, all they're saying.
but the version on this album is done in reggae with Aerosmith. And I was like, this is really neat. and then they do a reggae version of Imagine. That's kind of cool. A-ha's version of Number 9 Dream is the first non-reggae version we have on this album. And it's this great, almost like early 80s soft rock type version of the song, which is, and I wrote down intriguing. And then did you guys listen to the Love song, which I think is number 4 or 5?
No.
It's done by Angelique Montigny. And I think, I could be wrong, I think she takes the song and turns it into a minor chord progression, which actually gives it a really, really sad tinge to this song.
I'd be curious to hear that. Have you heard the song where someone took Let It Be and put it through Melodyne and turned it into minor?
No.
Wow.
Yeah, that was real interesting. It's much more of a resignation feel than a kind of moving on positive feel. It's really interesting.
Now, for people that like techno, there's techno on here as well. So there's DJ MJ doing Power to the People, which is very techno.
To the people.
And then we have the Deftones doing a heavy metal electronica version of Jealous Guy, which really, in some ways, actually really resonates with that song. It comes across as a very angry type version of Jealous Guy. And then there's this beautiful Calypso version of Beautiful Boy by Fleshly Ground, which is just like, I was like, I could listen to this all day. It's a great, amazing version.
And it's a beautiful song anyway. Like
it is. Paul was talking with one of John's kids. I don't remember which one off the top of my head. I want to say it was his oldest. They were interviewing each other, and Paul said that that was one of his favorite solo John Lennon songs. And I've always loved it.
Yeah, I mean, it's a great song. It's I'm a big fan of Watching the Wheels.
There's a really cool version of what you would expect, Green Day singing Working Class Hero.
Yeah, that's about a perfect outside of maybe Bob Dylan.
Exactly. They're like, we can't get Bob Dylan. Let's go with Green Day. Green Day would cover that. And then there's two different versions of Whatever Gets You Through the Night. One is great like song. French punk sound, and then the other one's like the slow Latin type version. Very intriguing. REM's Number 9 Dream and The Cure's Love sound exactly what you would expect them to sound like.
Gavin Rosdale does Mind Games too. That's really interesting. Makes sense.
Tokyo Hotel did a version of Instant Karma that was very reminiscent of Marilyn Manson.
Oh, that's real interesting. I don't know who Snow Patrol are. Apologies.
But they did Snow Patrol. Chasing Cars.
I'm pretty sure I've heard that. Snow Patrol. Irish. Northern Irish. That's an important distinction. / Scottish rock band. Interesting. I'll have to check it out because I love Isolation. That's one of my favorite Lennon tunes.
We'll do it all. Everything. On our own.
Oh, yeah,
if I just lay here, that's Chasing Cars. That's Snow Patrol. Yeah.
Okay.
That's cool. the only song that most people know.
Yeah.
Snow Patrol.
I'll have to check out their Isolation cover because that sounds pretty good.
It sounds very similar to that in terms of like the sound like makes a lot of sense with what they're covering. I think anyone could go out to this album.
I'm pretty stoked about Jacob Dylan being on the album too, because I really loved the Wallflowers.
Underrated.
I agree. I really loved their first album. I mean, One Headlight was overplayed, but the rest of the album was really, really, I thought, really tight.
Avenue of Heartache, that's probably my favorite tune.
Good tune. And it was a great album. And I listened to that CD a lot came out.
And he does that song with Danny Harrison.
Wow.
Which, when I listened to it, I'm like, yep, this is very much a Jacob Dylan take on this song, but it works.
So now I'm sold. I will be listening to the whole album over the next few days.
It is interesting. So, it's really great. I mean, everyone will find something that they like off this album, really.
Cool. Major tangent, but I don't know if you guys are into Sean Lennon at all. I think he's fantastic. He's got some really great solo stuff. I recall going to see the Lennon Claypool Delirium live. And if you're a Primus fan, and if you're a Sean Lennon fan, that's a dream come true. And they played basically my favorite Primus song, Southbound Pachyderm, and they played one of my favorite Beatles tunes, Dear Prudence. So it was really cool to see them playing those together.
That would be interesting to listen to.
Recommend highly the Lenny Claypool Delirium. It's kind of nice, like basically psychedelic rock as channeled through Les Claypool and Sean Lennon. So.
But why don't we get to talking a little bit about Yoko? Which, like, one of the things about this album is there are multiple versions of the same song. I don't know who, I'm guessing that each band decided what they wanted to cover.
Yeah.
Because if the record company were doing it, they would parse it out so it was much more spread even. And it wasn't. Like, the big, Imagine was covered like five times.
right.
Which is fine, but I that just leads me to believe that each band decided what they wanted to choose, which brings me to wonder what made BNL. I'm not saying it was a bad choice, but what made BNL choose Yoko?
Tracy, they have a song.
Of course, they had to.
They have a song called "Be My Yoko Ono."
Yeah, well, that's, I think that's the reason.
When I say that, though, the reason I say it is, Yoko is a very personal tune.
Yeah, it's a good song too.
It is, but John Lennon, the record company, wanted to release it as a single off the Imagine album, and John Lennon said no. Which to me just tells me that it's not that he didn't believe in the song. It's that I think he felt it was too much of a personal song to release as a single.
Could be. He was also just a major contrarian.
I mean, no, you never get that with any of his music.
Oh, no.
but yeah, I wonder if, I just want, like, it seems like such a personal song. It was like, okay, that's an interesting choice to go with something that is very much about one specific person. It's not that they don't do a great job with it.
Well, it's a very specific song, but it's also, I think, fairly universal in its theming. It's very simple. You know, it's a classic ballad. It's a love song through and through. And I think what I like about it is, you know, John has always been my favorite Beatle. I think growing up, you know, as a teen, an edgy, angsty teen, you know, I liked that he was a little more aloof and a little more ironic. But this is John at his most sincere and his most, you know, just kind of bare and not being ironic, not being aloof or anything, just putting his heart on his sleeve and just writing a straight up, very, very simple, very sincere love song. And I think that's one of the things I like so much about this song.
It is extremely simple, right? With a lot of verses.
yeah. It's almost like folk in that sense. It's like, especially, we'll get into it, but yeah, the chorus barely differs from the verse. It's pretty much a three chord song.
Right.
It is a very simple song, and it's very repetitive, but I don't get bored of it. Like, it's enjoyable enough and playful enough and bouncy enough that it pulls me along for the ride. I mean, that's just me and that's my opinion, but I've also said in the past I hate repetitive songs. So, like, there's something about this one that works better and really gets caught.
I like this more than Give Things a Chance is what you're saying.
Exactly. No, I think it's, the Give Peace a Chance is so repetitive in that it keeps repeating exactly the same word over and over and over and over and over that I'm just like, okay, enough. This one is bouncy, and I think that's why I like it more with that repetition, but also it's repetitive, but there's a lot of breaks in between. There's a pattern that's more repetitive than anything else. Does that make sense?
Yeah, well, it's almost more like a folk song in that sense, but there's still some differentiation. Yeah, I know. I mean, Give Peace a Chance is more or less, it's more of a songified, if I can coin a phrase, like a songified protest chant, you know what I mean? More first. Mm-hmm. It's like a protest chant first that it kind of turned into a song via recording. And this is more of a folksy ballad kind of, but like with the kind of pop rock 70s, 80s sensibilities that you'd expect from Lennon.
Yeah, because this song was used in the film Rushmore.
Rushmore, right.
So yeah, I knew this was in Rushmore. I actually made notes about it. I was going to talk about it. I love Rushmore. Yeah, I love John Lennon. I love Wes Anderson. Yeah, I wrote in my notes, I can't hear this, even this version, without thinking about Rushmore. Yeah, I thought it was the original in Rushmore.
It was.
Okay. Love that movie. It's a great montage. I haven't seen it in forever, but it's used to great effect in that movie.
Yes. Let's talk about the difference between this version and the original. So which one I like. Yeah, why don't we break it down? Let's go with that. Aaron, do you want to break it down, or Heidi, do you want to break it down?
Let's tag team it.
Why don't you start? Because I'm curious.
Okay. All right. So, Oh Yoko, this version by Bare Naked Ladies was recorded at 170 beats per minute.
That's what I had.
And performed in the key of C major.
I was right.
Which, if I were the pianist for this tune, I would have died of relief. Since the original was recorded in the key of B flat or C sharp, which is just a small step shy worse than C flat, in my opinion.
Aaron, can I just say how happy I am? Because I said this to Tracy last night. I was like, okay, so I searched and searched, and I got a lot of different information when I tried to plug it. And so I finally just sat down at the piano. I was like, oh, wait, this is in C. Yeah, C. What the heck? And I was right.
I wanted to see what Aaron was going to say to see if it matched up with what you said last night.
Yeah, I mean, so a little background on me. I'm a vocalist and a drummer first, and I'm a pianist or you know, synthesizer player, a distant third. So for me, if someone, you know, first of all, I'm unprofessional enough that I usually don't use sheet music, but if someone does put sheet music in front of me and I see more than a few accidentals in the key signature, I'm gonna throw something. So if I see something in C flat or I don't know, E sharp or something ridiculous, I'm gonna get angry. So I would have hated to have played it in the original key signature, but C major is obviously C major and A minor are basically the two easiest keys to play on the piano. So, yeah, very nice there. The verse structure, very simple. It's C, G, A minor, very simple. So 1, 5, 6. The chorus is C to G, then back mm-hmm. to C, and then C to G to A. So it's kind of cuts out the six or the A minor for the first mm-hmm. time, then it goes back to the regular. And then we go to the F major chord for the turnaround. My love will turn you on. That's pretty much it. Unless I missed something, Heidi. We have maybe a passing chord here or there. Nope. But
I got the same thing. Yeah, I have a few, I have a 3-7 there as a passing chord at one point. But but overall, it was pretty much that. But I was like, because Tracy asked yesterday when we were discussing, when we were not going to have the meeting, but we discussed a little bit why you would go just a half step, and I said it's probably because it was easier.
It makes a world of difference to play for the
it makes
player.
A world of difference. And because it's piano based, playing in C sharp's a pain in the butt.
Oh my god, I would have
I don't know why. Well, so Tracy, if you don't know, C has no sharps and no flats. C sharp has seven.
Has all
of them. Gosh. Everything is sharp and flat. So not just all of the black keys, but also you're playing an E sharp, which is an F. You're playing a B sharp, which is
C. Which is C.
So it's very complicated. So when you ask why, because there's so much piano in this song, I'm sure that Kevin was like, oh, hell no. Really talented. I was like, no, it's a whole
it's
different
game. It's confusing, and it's like unnecessarily confusing. You know, I can't see. The only reason I mentioned C flat, C flat's almost like a joke scale. It's like something you do to troll someone because it's basically it's just B,
it
right?
Really
but
is.
You just write it in a confusing way.
Well, John liked to do that where he
he was kind of a troll, so I could see that.
But like the piano playing on the original is amazing considering what you just told me then.
I believe maybe it was a different tune. He had a guest pianist.
Yes.
I'm not sure if it was for this tune or if it was for Instant Karma.
I'm going to pull it up right now.
It was another British rocker dude who passed away in the 90s, if I remember correctly. I can't remember who it was. I'll say it was
I can tell you. The piano player was Nicky Hopkins, who played for Rolling Stones, Kinks.
Yes.
That makes sense. Okay.
Yeah.
But he must have been cursing John Lennon.
Like, John, mate, why couldn't you just make it in C? he wanted to show off that extra half step of range when he went for the high note, I guess. I'm not sure. Yeah, it couldn't have been. I mean, it was a half step down. It's not like it could have been that uncomfortable for it. Wasn't that? Yeah, that he had to have been doing that for maybe an inside joke. The only other counter argument I could think of is that John famously was, you know, not like a music theory kind of guy. So he would just kind of sit down at the piano and play something.
Yeah.
So it's possible he just kind of started playing and that's what it ended up being in. But even then, like for someone who, you know, is kind of just like plunks around on the keyboard, you know, I would much rather do it in C.
Well, my guess is he actually started this with guitar
because he wrote
it when he was in India in 1968.
Yeah. Guitarists, they don't care. They just slide their hand up and down the neck. It's so easy for them.
So true.
Yeah. Like when it comes down to it, he liked to just plink. He was not a music theory guy. He even would say I know nothing about theory.
What's interesting too is, and Aaron, I might agree with me here, is if you just play Black Keys and C sharp, if you don't know what you're doing, you can make it sound really, really cool because there's a lot of pentatonic scales going on. It's very bluesy sound. So you can not know anything about what you're doing. I mean, you know that all there. Like all of that stuff, pentatonic scale is that's all Black Keys or those keys. So you can see how it would be easy for somebody that wasn't. However, if you're trained and you're like, oh my God, forget about this. Like, this is nuts.
Well, I think, that's actually, you know what, Heidi? Yeah. That's actually really, really insightful because the more I think about it, they came from a blues background where like classic rock and roll evolved from the blues. And you are absolutely correct. When I learned music, it was like a classical thing where you start with C major and then they start introducing accidentals. So you go to F and B flat and stuff like that. Right. But I'm sure they learned like B flat blues first. That was probably the first thing they learned, that and the pentatonic scale. So you're absolutely right. That's probably exactly where they come from, that blues background.
And apparently the melody being inspired by like more of a folk song by Lonnie Donegan, that makes a lot of sense too.
Yeah.
So like, hold on, I'm trying to find the Lonnie Donegan song.
I listened to it and I can see the inspiration. It does not sound anything similar to but it, like in terms of like.
He was the king of skiffle. What is British skiffle?
Skiffle is actually what the Beatles. Yeah,
right.
It's basically like rocked up versions of old blues songs, or not blues, like folk songs. Like My Bonnie Lies Over the Ocean was one of the first Beatles tunes. Right. So that's skiffle. They took it and they shuffled it. They swung it, and they put some mild distortion, I guess, on maybe.
Well, and that's what the Quarrymen were. Like the Quarrymen did skiffle almost. Yeah, and that's really John and Paul were big on. Wabash,
Cannonball, I'm Alabama Bound, Wreck of the Old 97, Frankie and Johnny. These are definitely just traditional old folk songs. So that makes a total sense of why it's in the key that it's in.
Yeah, they probably learned on all those old blues keys. And so when he first sat down the piano, he probably like, and started on B flat and went up pentatonic scale. And I bet you're absolutely right. So it's just approaching things from a different starting point.
I just would love to know what
you're used to.
what Nicky thought when he came in and had to do the piano, if he was like, oh, you're kidding me.
I mean, I'm the kind of guy who, if somebody handed me a C sharp, I would probably just have to sit down with it for a little while and then kind of work it out in my head, because I would be so tempted every time I was going to play. It's just unnatural to play in quote unquote E sharp. You know what I mean? Cause you're playing F and it's so contrary in your head. It's a nightmare for me. I'm sure somebody has been playing piano like in bands for years. You know what I mean? I've played quote unquote for years, but like,
he played with the Rolling Stones. He played with the Kinks. Like, this is a guy that played with lots of blues based bands. So
it probably wasn't that difficult for him, to be honest. But for me, I would run away screaming.
I don't know if this is because of the keys, like the change in chord, or if this is because of the way that John's voice is. I think the big difference between the two versions is John's comes off as more relaxing.
Yeah.
And BNL's comes off as powerful.
Yeah, they put a little more power behind it, which I liked. You know, I appreciated it. I think I prefer the original. I'm going to go ahead and say it now. And that's, you know, A, because I'm a huge John Lennon fan. And I really do enjoy this song. And B, I think that his is more tender and heartfelt and sweet. And this is still like, I 100% like, I know that the Steve and Ed are big, you know, Beatles fans, and I'm sure they really legitimately love this song too. And I don't really hear, it's not like one of those covers. We've had a few covers now that we've talked about where they were kind of taking the piss, as the Brits would say. They were definitely taking this seriously, and they clearly care about this song. So it's a well done cover. It's very good. But yeah, the feel is probably the biggest difference.
I think you bring up a good point, though. Like, there's a difference between loving the song and loving the person the song is about. Mm. And I think that's kind of that thing that's different, is John is singing about this person that he loves so dearly, and it comes across as tender. And his voice leads to that anyways. That's his voice naturally. Versus... you know, BNL loved this song, and you can hear the joy in it, but that's, joy is different than love, is different than tenderness, you know?
Yeah, I know, I totally agree. I mean, first of all, when you listen to the lyrics of Be My Yoko Ono, you can tell, I mean, they're being silly, but they're also kind of legitimately saying, like, hey, you know, don't blame the breakup on Yoko, because it really wasn't her fault. You know, correct. She was blamed when it was really more like about money and artistic differences and ego. It was way more about those things than any part that Yoko may have played. And in fact, it's kind of prescient that we're talking about this now because of the new Peter Jackson documentary that came out.
Right.
And you can really see, like, I love that Yoko's there, but she's not like, she's just knitting. You know what I mean? She's not letting them do their thing. She's not like bossing people around or doing anything. No. Like, the way that you've heard all these tales and people
just so gossiping. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's Paul puts it great that when he's sitting there and they're talking, when John's not around, that day that Harrison left and the day that John didn't show up because Harrison was gone, or that he was, you know, like 6 hours late.
Right.
And Paul's talking, and he's like, you know what? I understand where John's coming from. They're in love. They want to be around each other all the time. And she's really not that invasive. She's just here.
Right.
Like, in the meeting, she was a little bit, she was talking for John all the time. But when it comes down to it, like when it's music business, when it's the process of making the music, she's not there.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. So
I think it's like what the urban legend of it all has become the bigger story of.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, and they pointed out that I saw this one YouTuber that was talking about it, and they pointed out, like, the person that we see on Get Back that was doing the documentary he kind of had it in for certain people and had an anger about it, and had an anger about the fact there was no direction for the film when they were filming it. And he even mentions, like, we don't have a direction for this film. We don't have a plot line. We don't have anywhere we're going with it. And I think he decided he was going to make a plot line that happened when they did it, when they did the Let It Be film. Like, I'm going to make something happen here that will interest people, but it's not. It's pretty frustrating to see them getting along 90% of the time, and even their arguments aren't really that heated.
Yeah, a lot of that was overblown and dramatized, and you know, I think that's kind of why I was kind of wincing when I first started watching, because Get Back or whatever the original was, there was a lot of acrimony, but that was apparently like condensed from like, what was it, 90 hours or something like that, or more of over 100 hours of footage. That's what they chose. So it was definitely telling a story. I mean, look, I thinking back on some of my band rehearsals, if you took the worst things we said to each other during all those rehearsals, we'd sound like we hated each other, but we loved
no
each other.
No kidding.
Yeah. So, I mean, you can watch it and you can see that, okay, yes, Paul can be controlling at times. And, you know, when Paul loves a song, he'll make you repeat it over and over and over again until it's dead to you, like Maxwell's Silver Hammer, which is why the rest of the band hated it. And he's like, I love this song.
Yeah.
You know, he had that tenacity about him. And you can see that with Get Back, because there are certain songs that they literally play for the full day. And they're like, can we please be done with this?
Right.
But they never appeared like outwardly like furious about it. Like it was the most tame anger outbursts I've ever seen.
Yeah, ultimately, I like Yoko. I think a lot of the stuff that she does is very experimental, and I think a lot of people I don't want to say they don't understand it, but they just don't care to. Maybe they don't really take the time. Like she's, I remember reading a book where she had different like songs, or like I think she called them songs, but some of them were just like instructions. So it'd be like take a mason jar and then put it under a light bulb for a minute, and then put the lid on the jar, and then now you have a jar of that light bulb's light or something like that. You know, it's like I think it's kind of fun and interesting and funny what she did. And I think a lot of people were like, oh, she's just pretentious or whatever. And it's like, I think she's being playful all the time.
Yeah. I mean, she was a different type of artist. She was very much like what modern and postmodern art is compared to like Renaissance classic art. Mm. And there's nothing wrong with that. You either like it or you don't. Speaking of like it or don't, Steven has covered this song twice on his Live from Home concert.
Yeah, I saw that too. Very interesting. But it's a good song for Steven. It is.
Oh, yeah.
It is. And it just fits his voice so well. I do love the harmony, though.
I made those are my notes. So hold on. So I said the reverb is actually pretty reminiscent of what Lennon used on that album. So I got this real nostalgic feeling from the reverb. I love the high tremolo organ solo. Between the organ and the harmonica work, it almost has like a Dylan-esque sound, save for the vocals, of course. And speaking of which, I love the vocal harmonies. That's probably the best part of this tune, I agree.
I don't know if that's Steven doubling up on himself, doing the harmonies and the leads, or if it's Ed doing Steven the Ed, backs. But
it's hard to tell, you're right. Sometimes it's hard to tell.
Yeah, but well, they have them blended so well together, you can't really easily pull them out.
Right.
Which to me, that's a sign of our excellent harmony when you can't pull them out because they blend so beautifully together.
Yeah, so, it would be like Simon and Garfunkel.
I listened to this a lot over the last week. 20 times is definitely an underestimate. And I did not notice until I had my speakers on blast because the family wasn't home the other day.
Nothing you can do that can't be done.
Yes.
Yes.
At the very end.
I love, like, that little detail. The All You Need Is Love lyrics at the fade out. I love that.
Which is hilarious because John Lennon's stuff was given to Amnesty, but the Beatles stuff was not. That's a different catalog. Yeah. So,
well, didn't Michael Jackson own that for a long time?
Oh yeah, he still does. Well, so I'm sitting
doesn't
there and,
anymore because
well, he doesn't own anything, Tracy.
He doesn't own anything.
His estate owns it.
Well, that got dark real quick.
Wow.
But I love the fact that like that's definitely copyright infringement, but they don't care. They just mix it in really low.
I mean, it was for charity. They're not making money off of it. They're helping people. I mean, look, I'm sure that somewhere there was a lawyer that would take that case, but I mean, have a heart.
I was going to say, that's kind of just cruelty at that point. The whistling during the bridge too.
Oh, yeah.
Which made me think of Jealous Guy.
It was a nice little addition, a nice little like, it very much rung true for Lennon because he liked to use that as well.
Going into like the lyrics of this are the simplicity of just the five words: night, bath, shave, dream, cloud.
Wow, yeah.
And I'm wondering if there's any, I don't think there's any real significance to that. I think it's just the daily mundane things that you do and you're still overwhelmed by this one human being. And I think that's the beauty of it. It's very simple and mundane instead of being ethereal and, you know, in the stars we walk together or any like random crap like that. It's like, hey, in the middle of the night when I'm in bed, when I'm taking a bath, when I'm shaving my face. And then it goes on to dream and cloud. But, you know, he starts off very mundane, like the usual kind of stuff you do with your significant.
I think that describes John and Yoko so well. Like there are couples that like they are connected. John and Yoko were intertwined. And I think this describes that very well.
And I think the love is what made it kind of ethereal. Like it turns the mundane into something more.
And you hear it in the way that the song is written, that he really, does he ever say that he loves her in this song? I don't believe so.
Because my love will turn you on, but no.
Turn you on, yeah. But yeah, like you just get the feeling that this guy is totally infatuated.
Yeah, it really comes through in the simplicity and then the earnestness of the song. That's what I really like about it. And as mentioned, yes, ever since watching Rushmore for the first time, I can't hear this song in any form without thinking of that film. Thank you, Wes Anderson. Although I actually don't mind because I really do love that flick. But yeah, I mean, it's very, so that's about it. You know, it's a simple song, but it's done very well. Both the original and the cover, I really like. I personally like the original just a bit better, but I mean, come on, that's like, you're going up against the Michael Jordan of the pop rock ballad, right? So, I mean.
Yeah.
Right. Now, if they had redone Imagine, we might have more words, but.
Yeah.
But I think I agree with Aaron.
But I think that's another reason that that's a good choice. Like, how do you, unless you're going to do a completely different take on this, on Imagine, why would you bother doing?
Well, a Perfect Circle did a really interesting, very minor, dark take on Imagine. And Godhead did a pretty great cover of Eleanor Rigby. Oingo Boingo covered I Am the Walrus, and it was pretty good. But that's the thing. I always say, like, if you're going to cover the Beatles or Nirvana or some iconic band like that, you better either make it your own and or make it really good because otherwise, yeah it's just going to go down the tubes.
Well, that's the thing is you're going to be get yourself compared to the Beatles. Yeah.
But you can't help but make the comparison. That's the whole, it's there in the structure.
And because of that, you're comparing yourself to what people would say is the best band of all time. And you're going to therefore come across lackluster next to that versus, and if you make it your own, like a lot of bands on this album did.
Yeah, they changed the style and the feel completely. That's the smart way to go.
Yeah. Or if you're going to do a song where you're very, very religious to it and then do a song that's less well known like this one.
Yeah, my band covered Being for the Benefit of Mr. Kite, of all songs.
Really?
Yeah.
That would be
interesting. I'm sure there's a recording somewhere. I don't have one on hand, but I think I have an old mini disc somewhere.
Oh my gosh. That's amazing.
That was a fun one to do. We were a very circusy kind of band, so it fit our aesthetic pretty well.
That would fit your, yeah, I could definitely see that. Well, speaking about how well this song fits, let's discuss how well we feel that BNL did with this song, this cover.
Well, what's our rating system? We don't have Jeff. Heidi, you want to do this one?
Let's see. Oh my goodness. What can we...
Not to put you on the spot.
I'm thinking of the words night, bath, shave, dream, cloud.
How many P's do we give a chance to?
How many karmas?
Ooh, yeah. How many instant karmas? How many darfers?
How many darfers? Oh, I don't know if that's appropriate.
That's a really dark turn. I was going to go with just how many Yokos.
But... Yeah, okay, we can do that. How many Yokos?
Honestly, yeah.
I'm too tired to think at this point.
How many mason jars full of light?
Right. Well,
jars full of light, exactly. Heidi, how many jars full of light do you give this?
A million jars of light. I would give this, like Aaron said, I am pretty much in alignment fully. I'm just really super proud of myself that we have the exact same harmonic analysis. So that makes me happy.
Yes,
I also like the original better, but because it's a love song from one human to another, it's always going to be better from the original artist. But I give it, it's a really well done remake, I feel. So I'm going to give it a 4.3.
Ooh, nice. Very nice.
All right. Aaron, what about you?
Well, Heidi, I got to ask, was that a George H.W. Bush reference?
A million points of light.
Thousand jars of light.
Thousand jars of light.
Not going to do it.
I've consistently mentioned in podcasts prior how simplicity is not a bad thing and can be quite nice if it's executed well. And I believe I've used the Beatles as an example of this. So it should be no surprise that I quite like both the original tune and this cover. Yeah, I mean, I will definitely include it in my best of playlists. So spoiler alert there. I think there's a lot of material that I put above it, but it definitely deserves to be on there. So I would give Oh Yoko a very solid 4.1 jars of light out of 5.
Okay. I dig that. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to be the contrarian on this one. I like this version more than John's version. And I think it's just because of the fun versus the tenderness. And I just love the fun that I hear coming from Steve and Ed and the rest of the band with this version. And I sing along with this version more than John's version.
Yeah, I can see that.
And so, like, to me, I really, really love this version. I would say that this is possibly the second best cover song that they have ever done.
It's a very good cover.
It's a very good cover.
Wait, what would your first be then?
The first would be Lovers in a Dangerous Time.
Oh, absolutely.
That's a pure 5 for me because they outdid the original, in my opinion. This one is really, really close to John's version. So I'm going to give this one a 4.5.
Nice.
So, and we don't know yet what Stefan and Jeff will give this. We'll hear about that probably at the end of the year. I know that you couldn't make it this week. You have a new job and all, so it might take a few weeks before we can get you again. But we'll try doing this until then.
Yeah, well, I'm not sure when I'll be available. So it looks like I'm going to be working the overnight shift down in Scarborough.
Yeah.
So we'll see.
It may be a while.
It might be a while. Yeah.
But we want your opinion. So what is your opinion on this song?
Well, it's short, that's for sure. it being kind of a tribute to John Lennon, I expected it to be, you know, have a little bit more meat on its bones. Well, I thought the lyrics were limited, most definitely limited. I can see how he was possibly trying to emote emotions through just how he was, you know, how he sung the song rather than anything else. But Bare Naked Ladies doing it. The instrumentals were great. There was a harmonica in there. That was pretty cool. I'm not going to lie. And the lyrics, well, they didn't butcher that, because if it's as best to cover, then that's the same, I guess. Yeah, so, you know, I didn't think too highly of the song because I thought it was very overly simplistic. Okay. But the instrumentals were great. I don't know who was on instrumentals, but I thought that was solid. They really pulled that off. At least it was weak and lacking in that front. So, that being said, I don't know, what did I rank this song? Let me see. I think I ranked it like a 1.75.
1.75?
Yeah. Yeah, because it's short. The instrumentals were great. Lyrics are like, meh. But, you know, it's okay. I would never put this on my playlist, much less put it on an album. But hopefully John Lennon's was better. I think BNL kind of sung it like Yoko was, you know, a pet that made a mess on the rug. And they're like, oh, Yoko. You know what I mean? It's like, now I got to clean that up. So, anyway, that's my take on things.
All right, thank you, sir.
But yeah, oh, you're very welcome. Hey, I went back and I reviewed a couple other songs. If you want to hear them, well, you know, you sent me a list of all the songs I had missed in 2021, and I started reviewing those. I also listened to the past couple songs that I had missed. Due to communication, to my phone, to my schedule being off, et cetera, et cetera. And I believe the two songs are Off His Head,
yep.
And Off the Hook.
That's correct.
So, but I also went through and I listened to another Postcard. I also listened to another Spin, Auld Lang Syne. I can never pronounce that song. I was in the process of listening to BNABCs as I got signed on to your Zoom call here. Well, I'm going to start off with Off His Head. And I liked it. It was a pretty decent song. I think the instrumentals were pretty good. I think that's the part that I liked the most is the instrumentals. I wasn't too sure about the lyrics or the singing. I thought it was, is okay, but it was a good song. I see the point of the meaning of it. It's like when somebody gets angry, especially with a dad, he gets off his head, and they were talking about how he gets angry and, you know, his reactions when he's going berserk and gets really angry. So I see that. As far as song, I thought it was pretty good. I didn't think it was the best. I didn't think it was the worst. And so I'm going to rank it 3.25. Now, I listened to Off the Hook back-to-back with Off His Head. And I probably shouldn't have because it made Off His Head sound a lot worse and Off the Hook sound a lot better. So I like the sound of Off the Hook. I like the sound of Steven brings to the band. I think it's great. I think the music that was behind it as well was just solid. It sounded great. It was a good sound. I would put this on my playlist. I would listen to this quite a bit. I also liked the lyrics. I think the lyrics were quite, not necessarily poignant, but I mean, it was pretty cool how he is associated with different things having to do with relationships. And I thought that was That was really, really nice. I like that. And he brought up a lot of truths within the song. So, that being said, I would put it on my playlist. I liked it as a whole. And I'm going to rank this thing a 4.5.
All right.
So, let's move on to another postcard, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
That one was weird for me. That one was weird. Not only about singing about chimpanzees, maybe I just didn't get it. It had a good beat to it. I thought the content was bizarre. And I kept on getting like a hint of another band. And I couldn't tell if it was Sublime or if it was Smash Mouth or I can't tell you what. But I think it was like another 90s band. And I'm like, man, this sounds familiar, but I just couldn't put my finger on it. Just couldn't do it. I didn't know who it was, but you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Did anybody else bring up anything like that?
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, I think I picked up a little bit of Sublime in there, I think.
Okay.
Or Smash Mouth, I don't know, but something about it kind of, it had to do with the instrumentals and the sound as a whole. Jeez, I wish I knew songs better. I'd be like, yes, I know the song and this is what it is. That's that song from Shrek, I think.
Oh, okay.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I'm not musically inclined. I think that's Smash Mouth. Anyways, that's kind of the vibe that I got from the song.
Okay.
Unfortunately, it didn't bring up my score any. I thought it was just above average. I would not put this on my playlist because it's just weird. So 2.75 is my ranking for another postcard.
Okay.
Yeah. So then I listened to another spin, and I found it quite monotone, kind of humdrum, blah, mm-hmm. blah, blah. The instrumentals, again, are great. You know, everybody's delivering on the music aspect of things, and it's just awesome. The lyrics, I couldn't really – I got them. I understood them. They're poignant, as always, with Bare Naked Ladies. I think the song itself was kind of monotone, and I think that's how they designed the song. But I didn't really like it too much, so – I thought that was below average. I'd never put this on my playlist, so I'm going to rank that at 2.
Okay.
Yeah. So, Auld Lang Syne. Hey, I think I said it right.
You did?
They couldn't have done it more perfect. I thought it was awesome. I mean, it gave me goosebumps, like the original song does. I thought it was just great. It sounded great. Steven is fantastic. And I think Ed took over one part of it too, didn't he?
Yep.
And yep. Anyways, I thought it was perfect. The instrumentals were perfect. They gave honor to the song. I found no flaws in it whatsoever. I have to rank that a 5.
Wow.
I have to do it because it was perfect. Absolutely perfect. Sung perfectly. Music was perfect. Everything was perfect on it.
Very interesting. So, all right. That is the highest score for that song.
Oh, no doubt.
Cool.
Well, I mean, it can be bad. I've heard bad versions of the song.
Oh, but that is true. There's nothing
that they did bad.
No,
it's great. It sounded great. I loved it. I would put it on a playlist, actually. going on to Baby Seat.
Ah, Baby Seat.
That one was interesting. I didn't finish the song because I had to get onto Zoom here. So I got through to the second chorus, not second chorus, but second whatever. Verse, I guess you could say. And I thought it was lyrically and meaningly an excellent song because I wasn't sure what to make of it. And it's like they're singing about, look, you need to grow up. You need to get out of that baby seat. And then I think they were singing about Mary Magdalene and Jesus.
Some people have actually had that thought, yeah.
And I'm like, wow, I don't think I would ever tell Jesus that he needs to get out of the baby seat. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that was interesting to me.
I think it's supposed to be more of, at least this was the take that we kind of came to, although I will agree with you, for a very long time I also kind of had that same take on it, especially as second verse kind of has a lot of symbolism that kind of gives that feel to it. I think we finally kind of came to the idea of it being a woman who is following a false prophet, a Maharishi, some sort of person who ends up being not truly what he says that he is, she learns that she needs to grow up and needs to no longer be following false idols and be herself.
Okay. Yeah, I can see that.
But I agree with you. Like, for a very long time, that was my take on the song as well.
Well, I mean, this is taking a lot of stuff directly from some of the scripture.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a lot about kissing of the feet and washing the feet. And then, of course, as far as we know, Mary Magdalene did not sleep with Jesus. So, because that was also in that verse as well.
Yeah.
Which was different, very much different.
Yes.
But as far as that goes, I thought it was smooth. I thought the music was very smooth. I thought the lyrics were smooth. I think it was very standard BNL. As far as creative, great music, the rhyming and the lyrics were, I think, really, really good and very poignant and made you think. And I think that's good classic BNL right there. So I haven't come up with a ranking for Baby Seat, but I'm going to come up with one right now. But I really liked it. I thought it was good. So I think I'm going to rank that a solid 4.
But I do have another cover that I have for our appearance this week. And the reason I'm using it for an appearance is that it's not really BNL covering it. It's Page, Stephen Page, Kevin Hearn, and Stephen Duffy covering Paul McCartney's Junk for a tribute album for Paul McCartney in 2001. I'll admit, Junk is definitely not one of my favorite Paul McCartney songs. It's not even really up there at all. It's probably in the lower end of my register of Paul McCartney songs. Hearing Stephen and Stephen's harmonizing high and low harmonies on that, though, were just so wonderful. And it's just beautiful. That's the only beautiful part, I think, of that whole song. But the rest of it is really, really cool to kind of just hear them doing a Paul McCartney tribute.
I'll have to check that out. It's interesting since Duran Duran was on that Amnesty International album. Now we've got a Stephen Duffy song. Did you do that on purpose?
I did.
Well, I appreciate it. Yeah, I mean, I'll be honest. I've always been, as far as the solo work, I've been a Lennon guy over a McCartney guy. Although, yeah, I'm definitely on team Band on the Run / Live and Let Die. I don't know about you guys as far as my McCartney tune.
I like new Duran Duran rather than older, like pre Stephen Duffy.
I like
Duran
new Coke Duran, said nobody ever.
Nobody
except
ever.
For Max Headroom.
Heidi, do you prefer old Duran Duran or new Duran Duran?
I prefer the new car smell. No, are you like no old Duran Duran because I was in middle and high school with old Duran Duran and. Like that was part of like getting up and going over to my friend's house to watch MTV and watching, you know, Hungry Like the Wolf videos and stuff. I was like, totally. Well,
but I don't think he was
when you say new Duran Duran, you mean like post 2000, like the reunion?
No.
Yeah.
No, I mean like,
oh, that's what I thought you were talking about.
Like pre Duffy. Oh. Post Duffy.
Post Duffy. Definitely.
I like post Duffy better.
Yeah. No, I was thinking you were thinking like, what I consider Duran Duran versus
okay
2000.
That's a little different. Like, yeah.
Do you like old Genesis or new Genesis?
Oh, Gabriel.
Oh, are you
Gabriel Genesis
me?
All night, all day, all year.
See, I disagree. I'm a huge Phil Collins fan, and here's the story. I growing up super poor, and when I first got my first cassette tape player, which was not a real Walkman, it was a piece of crap like
Walkman
with headphones. But the first cassette our neighbor loaned me was Face Value, and I listened to I Can Hear Through These Walls, and it blew. And Saturday Night and Sunday, like there's so many good songs that Phil has come out with, but I became obsessed with Phil, which then brought me to Genesis. And like I saw Genesis live post Gabriel, because he left much earlier than I saw them in concert, obviously. But I have an appreciation for Gabriel. I really love Gabriel's solo work. Oh, yeah. In fact, I think So is one of he has some of the best solo albums out there. Bizarre. And I saw Peter Gabriel live as well. Ooh, and he was amazing. But Phil, there was something about Phil's like filling my ears as a sixth grader in a crap little apartment with these little tiny earbuds going, don't let him steal your heart away. Getting into Genesis is a whole like rabbit hole I could go down. But like I really love, you know, Lamb Lies Down on Broadway, and I really love, like, there is some really cool stuff. And I think Genesis, especially in the 70s and 80s, like I think Phil carried a lot of Genesis's style with him, not just because he was the lead singer after he was drummer, but I think pulling him from the drum kit and bringing him forward really changed everything for Phil Collins.
Yeah.
I don't think we would have the Disney connection with Phil Collins that we do now, and all of the other things that Phil Collins has done, and not just in the air tonight, obviously.
Oh, you mean but, look? I mean,
oh yeah, that's right. He's the police officer.
That's right.
In Hook. That's
right.
I love Phil Collins. Don't get me wrong.
And he was in Buster too. Did you see Buster?
No.
It wasn't terrible.
It
wasn't great, but it wasn't terrible.
But yeah.
It was a movie about a train robber, and he named Buster, a real life a true story, but not really that true.
All right, I got a harder question for you guys, and Jeff's not here, so I can ask this. Do you prefer the old apartment or the new apartment?
Oh, good segue. Good segue.
I didn't set that up 10 minutes ago.
Nicely done. Nicely done. Well, the old apartment smell is always kind of like home, isn't it? I think I prefer the old because it's comfy and lived in. It's got that, you know, that feel. Unless it's full of dirty yuckiness and socks and stuff, and then no.
Like the old fish rack.
But a brand new apartment has that new paint smell and the new carpet smell, and it's just not, it's not a good smell.
A little
smell.
Chemical-y.
Yeah, it's a little, it's too sanitary. Like,
well, you know, the old apartment has a dish rack and an old mouse trap. So, you know.
So everything's going over my head. I know that that's got to be the new song for next week.
That is next week's song. And of course, hopefully we'll have Jeff back, because we have to have him on to talk about the old apartment. Like, we can't not have the guy who parodied the old apartment on for the old apartment. Like,
one would hope.
So,
Yeah,
but come back next week and join us for that.
Yeah. Well, it's been great talking about this song with the both of you. Like, I love this song.
It really has. Yeah. Now Aaron and I have to start a new podcast about Genesis.
Oh, Phil, my God. And, yes, I can be team Peter Gabriel. You can be team Phil Collins. But honestly, I love, don't get me
wrong. Oh, my God, debatable.
Land of Confusion. There's some great Collins stuff. Like, nothing...
Oh, Land of Confusion. The video for Land of Confusion is still one of the most innovative music videos.
The crazy Muppets. Of all time.
But if they had never
Ronald
left,
Reagan with his finger on the button. Oh my God.
But if Peter had never left, we never would have gotten Steve.
You wouldn't have gotten Invisible's Touch.
We wouldn't have gotten any of his individual. Like, we never really would have heard Steam or any of that individual stuff that he ended up doing, which was also phenomenal.
We might not even have In Your Eyes.
No.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Catapulted that's true. John Cusack well, to start
we him. Had, say we wouldn't have had Salisbury Hill if he hadn't left. But no, I think
of how many movies would be lacking appropriate background songs.
To me, though, it's because my mom was a huge Phil Collins fan. So I grew up listening to Phil Collins. And honestly, I credit Phil Collins with probably being one of the big influences of me becoming a drummer, because my dad had this awesome stereo system. So we'd crank up In the Air Tonight and I would just hear those like super mic drums. And I was like, oh yeah, I got to do that. But knowing Genesis as Phil Collins Genesis, and then going to music school and then meeting a friend who was like, oh, haven't you heard the Peter Gabriel stuff? And then they gave me a copy of Nursery Crime. And I was like, oh, my God, this is so good.
Yeah, you're right.
So good.
Yeah. And thinking, I didn't realize Space Value came out in 81.
I know.
Like, that whole album is so pretty much gold. Thunder and Lightning is amazing. Roof is Leaking kills me. The roof is leaking and the wind is howling. The kids are crying because the sheets are so cold. I still have it in my head.
Yeah.
I'm not looking at any lyrics or anything, but you know what I mean? I'm not moving. I'm not going. His use of horn line.
Oh, yeah.
Holy. Oh my gosh. Anyway, you would lose. I would totally take you out.
To be continued.
Just kidding.
To be continued.
Just kidding.
Oh my gosh. Well, that was awesome.
Well, we get to hit a song next week that is going to be, it'll be interesting if it's divisive. I highly doubt it will be divisive, but it'll be an interesting discussion.
Oh, it will. But I'm team the old department always.
Oh, yeah. That's why I said Jeff's not here. We can say that. Well, thank you guys. I appreciate it.
Yeah.
Thank you, everybody. Thanks, Aaron. I'm glad it was a threesome tonight. Oh, wait.
It's all right. I'm single again. We can say that.
Trios are better than duets. Trios are always better than duets. Yeah. So a triad is better than an interval.
It's true.
Oh, there's a music reference.
Because otherwise, you're not getting all the qualities of the chord. All right.
Right. Exactly. We're good.
Have a
We're
great
good.
Week.
We're so smart.
I'll see you guys next week.
All right, everybody.
Yes, Tuesday.
Good night,
next
everybody.
Week. Tuesday.
Tuesday.
Okay. Good night.
Good night. Bye.
Thanks. That was fun. Don't forget. No regrets. Except maybe.
To celebrate joining Pantheon Podcasts, Rock Camp, the podcast, the official podcast of Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, is giving away a guitar signed by Mike Portnoy of Dream Theater, Marty Friedman, formerly of Megadeth, and legendary shredder Zakk Wylde, plus our rock star counselors like Vinny Appice, Monty Pittman, and more. To enter to win, simply follow, rate, and review our podcast on your preferred platform, and that's all you have to do. For more information, go to rockcamp.com/podcast.